the early 1950s, a young researcher named Eugene Aserinsky was working late nights at the University of Chicago. He had rigged up an ancient brainwave machine, the Ofner dynograph, in his lab. One December evening in 1951, he attached electrodes to his 8-year-old son, Armand, who lay asleep in his cot. As Armand fell asleep, Aserinsky noticed something unusual. The pens tracking his son's eye movements and brain activity were moving, suggesting that Armand was awake. But when he checked, Armand was fast asleep. This unexpected observation led Aserinsky to discover rapid eye movement, or REM sleep. And when he published his findings in 1953, they revolutionized sleep research. Before REM was identified, sleep was thought to be a passive state where the brain just switches off. But Aserinsky's discovery revealed that the brain cycles through different stages during sleep, including REM and non-REM stages, each with distinct physiological and biochemical characteristics. We began to understand that sleep is not a uniform process, but a dynamic state, and this had significant implications for our understanding of the brain and sleep disorders. Aserinsky's discovery laid the foundation for modern sleep research and the development of polysomnography, or PSG. Polysomnography involves measuring lots of different physiological signals during sleep, things like brain waves, eye movements, muscle activity, heart rate, and respiratory function. All of this usually takes place in a sleep lab, and it's used to diagnose sleep disorders like sleep apnea, insomnia, and narcolepsy. But more recently, the emergence of wearable sleep trackers has made sleep monitoring mainstream. Wearable devices from companies like Fitbit, Apple, and Garmin provide users with insights into their sleep patterns, including total sleep time, sleep stages, and sleep efficiency. So in this lecture, we'll be talking about sleep tracking with consumer wearables and how it compares with the gold standard of polysomnography. I'll be going through the strengths and limitations of each approach, the validity of consumer wearables, and the factors to consider when choosing a device. So polysomnography, PSG, is the gold standard for sleep analysis, and it involves recording lots of physiological signals while you sleep. During a PSG study, you'll sleep in a lab for at least one night, sometimes more, and you'll have electrodes and sensors attached to different parts of your body. One will measure your brain waves using electroencephalography, or EEG. These EEG signals are used to classify your sleep into different stages: wakefulness, non-rapid eye movement, or NREM sleep, and rapid eye movement, or REM sleep. NREM sleep is then divided into three stages, N1, N2, and N3, with N3 being the deepest stage of sleep. Another electrooculography sensor will capture your eye movements. The rationale is simple enough. Rapid eye movements are characteristic of REM sleep, while slow rolling eye movements can indicate the transition into sleep. An electromyography, or EMG, sensor will measure your muscle activity. These are usually placed around the jaw or sometimes on the legs to monitor muscle tone. You see, during REM sleep, muscle tone is typically quite low, so this is another way for us to identify this stage of sleep. Then we have an electrocardiography, or ECG, sensor for measuring your heart rate and rhythm, both of which can change during different sleep stages. Your respiratory function will also be assessed via your nasal airflow, movements of your thorax and abdomen, and also your blood oxygen saturation. These measurements are needed for diagnosing sleep-related breathing disorders like obstructive sleep apnea. So all of these signals are combined to give the sleep lab technician a detailed picture of your sleep architecture. Sleep stage scoring used to be performed manually by a trained sleep technologist who would examine your sleep in 30-second epochs and then would classify them into wakefulness, NREM stages, N1, N2, and N3, and REM sleep based on established criteria. But more recently, with advances in machine learning and signal processing, automated scoring algorithms have been developed. These algorithms analyze the extracted features and classify sleep stages with high accuracy, reducing the time and effort required for manual scoring. Either way, the output of all of this data capture, synthesis, and analysis is what's known as a hypnogram, which is just a graphical representation of sleep stages over the course of the night. The kind of thing you'd be used to seeing if you own a wearable that measures sleep, and which is supposed to help in understanding sleep architecture and identifying abnormalities. When it comes to consumer wearable devices like Fitbits or even research-grade devices like actigraphs, the core technology that was used, at least in the early days, was actigraphy or actigraphy. Actigraphy involves wearing a small, usually wrist-worn device that tracks your movement patterns over days or weeks. These devices contain accelerometers that detect motion. The core idea is that less movement typically indicates sleep, while more movement suggests wakefulness. Now, considering all the different physiological signals that are measured through polysomnography, it shouldn't really come as a surprise that actigraphy can't provide the kind of detailed physiological data that polysomnography does. Still, actigraphy can be a useful tool for tracking general sleep patterns and identifying potential issues. And the technology is evolving. The algorithms are improving, and recently, wearables have started to incorporate more than just actigraphy to measure the quantity of sleep. Newer devices not only track movement with actigraphy, but also combine this with measures of heart rate, heart rhythm, and respiratory rate, all via photoplethysmography, skin temperature, and blood oxygen saturation. The challenge is that each company, so Apple, Google, Garmin, Fitbit, Oura, and all the others, tends to use their own proprietary algorithms to process different combinations of these signals. And those algorithms, or their outputs, are rarely validated against our gold standard of polysomnography. So how do we validate these devices? Well, researchers typically conduct studies where participants wear the consumer device while simultaneously undergoing a PSG study in a sleep lab. By comparing the sleep stages and metrics reported by the wearable to those recorded by polysomnography, researchers can assess the accuracy of the wearable. The results can be quite mixed. So for example, many wearables are pretty good at estimating total sleep time and identifying when you're asleep versus when you're awake, but they usually struggle with accuracy distinguishing between different sleep stages like light, deep, and REM sleep. One of the big challenges is that wearables primarily rely on movement and heart rate data, while PSG captures a much broader range of physiological signals. And this can lead to discrepancies. So for example, if you lie very still while awake, a wearable might mistakenly think you're asleep. Conversely, small movements during sleep might be interpreted as wakefulness. So as I've already mentioned, some of the more advanced wearables incorporate additional sensors like skin temperature and blood oxygen levels to improve their accuracy, but the core challenge remains the limited scope of the data they collect compared to PSG. So what's the most accurate device? Well, it's difficult to say. While there are lots of reviews on social media by different influencers advocating for one device over another, the reality is that these reviews rarely incorporate PSG. And when they do, it's usually on a limited number of people or sometimes on a single person, the reviewer themselves. So the results are very difficult to generalize. The other issue is that every time there's a new device release or another software update, all the old validation work needs to be updated. And because a research study can take months to conduct and sometimes years to publish, it's almost impossible for scientists to keep up with the commercial ecosystem. That's not to say they haven't tried, though. Our research group, for example, has recently conducted research seeking to synthesize all of the papers published to date, evaluating the accuracy of consumer wearables for lots of different metrics, including sleep. And we found that wearables like Apple Watches and Fitbits can provide a moderately good estimate of overall sleep time, but they're poor when it comes to measuring things like architecture, things like the different stages of sleep, such as REM and deep sleep that I discussed before. We're also in the middle of setting up a lab solely focused on validating new devices as they're released, but this work is ongoing. So I can't give you a definitive recommendation of what device to use yet, but I would highlight one thing. Whatever device you choose, you need to think about privacy. Wearables are becoming more and more common and more advanced. The data they capture can give all sorts of insights beyond just sleep. They could be used to give a picture of your overall health or, in the future, your risk of mortality. They could even be used to identify you. So whatever company you choose, you need to think about what happens all of that data that you are capturing about yourself. You need to read those end user license agreements, those terms of service, to get to grips with what you're giving away. How is the company collecting, storing, and using your data? And are they selling it? We'll be talking about those privacy and data governance issues next.